3 o'clock, so we'll go ahead and get started. I want to welcome all of you to the Mosaic Classroom and the University of Florida IFAS Range Cattle Research and Education Center here in Ona. Everyone in this room was at this morning's program at the Turner Center in Arcadia. And what we're going to do now for the next 2 hours is go over some of the Ona White Angus information that I shared with you this morning before lunch, and then we'll go on a tour. One of the things that we have going on right now is a webinar with individuals that were not able to join us here in Ona. So they're going to be able to see these slides and hear the discussion that we're having. And then they'll also be able to ask questions that we'll pick up that'll be typed to Andrea that she'll share with us as well. There's two individuals that have joined us for this afternoon, and that's Audie Spell here from Advanced Reproductive Associates and Todd Clemens from the Okeechobee Livestock Market. Both of these individuals are helping us with different parts of the management of the cow herd and the offering of the cow herd for sale. That's what we're going to focus more on here. The slides I'm going to show you right here, up to the information on the sale and the pictures, are exactly what you saw when we were at Arcadia. And then from that point on, I'm going to show you several pictures of the cattle that the people that are on the webinar will be able to see them. When we conclude with that, we'll take questions from the group. And anything that you might have that is related to reproductive technologies, what maybe can be done with the herd, Audie can help us with, and then questions that you might have regarding the sale and how we're going to work with producers' livestock auction on the sale, Todd can help us with. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and get started. Again, I want to welcome you here and thank you for your participation in today's field day. So, to start off, just what is the Ona White Angus? Some of my friends and colleagues have described them as crossbred cattle, and indeed they are have been derived from a crossbred project, a crossbreeding project, not unlike many other breeds. The white coloration is an anomaly that is not fully understood, and we're trying to understand that more as we go along. And they originally came to us from a cattle crossbreeding project that was led by a professor here in animal breeding named Mac Peacock. And what he did at that time is he was evaluating the performance characteristics from a three-breed cross that involved Brahman, Black Angus, and Charolais. And at the end of his study, that herd was bred to Simbra bulls. And so, that introduced a fourth breed, Simmental. And then starting in 1999, we began to breed that herd to Angus and Brangus bulls. In about 2002, we started to notice a large number, or at least a significant number, of calves that were born white, but sired by these Black Angus bulls. Now that in itself is not entirely unheard of. But being able to go back and breed those half-blood Angus to Black Angus bulls a second time and achieve that same phenotype with the dark skin and white hair coat was unexpected and rare. So since that time, we've been focusing at increasing their numbers and evaluating their offspring. So originally, we thought that we could produce 7/8 Black Angus with this white phenotype and dark hair or dark skin color. And that's what we've been aiming for. But it has not worked efficiently. Once we produce this white animal that's genetically 3/4 Black Angus and cross her to another Black Angus bull, the outcome is almost always black. And that is an important characteristic here, in that we see no other colors, no other dilution characteristics like Dr. Riley talked about with the smoky colored calves that some of you are familiar with. When we make these crosses, we either get white or we get solid black, one of the two. And producing the 7/8 Black Angus has not worked out well, although we do have several of them in our herd For example, like this heifer here in the picture, which is a 7/8 black Angus, and she's an ET daughter of the ABS bull mandate. So today, what we're doing is focusing on producing the 3/4 black Angus white cattle that we call the Ona White Angus. And we're doing it now by, once we get to the 3/4 objective, is breeding white on white, 3/4 to 3/4. So we're perpetuating the 7/8. If we look at some cows today, I'll point out some of the 7/8 that do exist, but we also have a few that are more than 3/4, not quite 7/8. And those originate because their grand dam was derived from a Brangus cross, okay? So there are some black Brangus in some of these lineages that have contributed to this as well. So just as an example of the plan that we had set forth, and we've used this to describe to some of the individuals that are interested in buying the herd of what we would do if we were to keep them. Now, if the herd does not sell, we will pursue this same outcome, but maybe not at the same level. Right now, the herd is limited on female genetics because we only have about 22 foundation cows. And what I mean by a foundation cow is these are cows that are half-blood black Angus, but are white, that we use to produce the Ona White Angus. And we do that by breeding them to purebred black Angus bulls. When you do that, we achieve approximately a ratio of 50-50, black and white. And so we're limited in terms of maternal side genetics by only these 22. But we have unlimited opportunities on the sire side because we can breed them to any purebred black Angus bull that's available in the marketplace. And so to increase the genetic diversity of the Ona White Angus, we feel that these cows need to be entered into a very aggressive embryo transfer, either through IVF or through traditional embryo transfer methods, to increase that population by breeding them to a number of different black Angus bulls. Now, on the other side, on your right side, that's an example of opportunity that could exist by rapidly increasing the Ona White Angus by using embryo transfer and breeding to our Ona White Angus bulls. And so on the left side, it's the foundation cows with multiple black Angus sires to produce the Ona White Angus. And on the right side, it's Ona White Angus on Ona White Angus using the reproductive technologies to achieve that. So what are the advantages? So one of the things that we did early on was look at sweating rates, respiration rates with the Ona White Angus. And we did this in collaboration with agricultural engineers from Cornell University. And we were one of the participating units. And they had a device that they were able to, within direct solar loads in the summer, measure the sweating rates of black-hided and white, I'm sorry, black-haired and white-haired cattle. What was interesting is that we did this in heifers, and the heifers were all half-sisters. They shared the same sire, but came from different dams. And what we found is that their sweating rate was 80% greater, the white cows than the black cows, suggesting that they could cool themselves much more efficiently. We've been able to see that this adaptive response results in cooler body temperatures, and collectively, we've shown that this results in less time that the white cows spend in shaded areas versus out and grazing in the sun. This is an example here of average vaginal temperatures of black versus white Angus cows during the heat of the summer. This is approximately a difference. This is in degrees Celsius, but I just calculated this before I came over, and that the white Angus at their peak are running about 102.2 degrees Fahrenheit versus 104.9 in the black Angus. And so this is at the peak heat of the day. Now, this is also in areas that are unshaded, all right? These data are all collected in pastures without shade. So, but certainly, given the same opportunity quite different in terms of their body temperatures as measured by vaginal temperatures. Then we also looked at the amount of time that these heifers spent in the shade during daylight hours. And so this is an example of the results. On a 12-hour day from 7 a.m., from 700 hours to 1900 hours, what percentage of that time was spent in the shade, with less time spent in the shade with the white cows versus the black cows. Now, we also looked at voluntary forage intake, just how much did those cattle eat when given free choice access to ground grass, and as expressed as a percent of body weight, and we see no differences between the two. Now, interestingly, we've sent several, over I think 3 or 4 years, bulls to the Florida test where they had an opportunity to go through the GrowSafe system and have estimates of efficiency measured. The bulls, in terms of their productivity, body weight gain, weight per day of age, they are, I would say, moderate, at the middle of the group or less than average. But in terms of efficiency of forage utilization, they are above average. And so these are just our standard bulls out of the herd. And so they've done quite well. So why are we selling the herd? So the genetic diversity of the Ona White Angus is limited, and I explained that to you by the limited number of the foundation cows that we have. But we have a plan to expand that number using reproductive technologies, but it's expensive. And we've talked a lot among ourselves and with our colleagues and the advisory council that we have here, which consists of stakeholders and producers here in Florida. And one of them told me something that I thought made a lot of sense, that it's a natural expectation of the university to develop technologies and move them on to private enterprise for commercialization. We might think about that more in gadgets than we do in live animals, but this is really a similar type of approach. So as a breed, we feel that the Ona White Angus has an opportunity to provide significant value, particularly in meat production systems in tropical and subtropical areas of the world. And so with that, now I want to just go in, particularly with the folks that are participating online, is show you some of our pictures of the herd. This is a cow here, number 74. She's a foundation cow. What do we mean by that? Well, she came from the original herd that was bred to Black Angus bulls. Those are her half-sisters behind her. That's the ones that are born black, and she's born white. Now, her mother could turn around next year and give birth to one of these black heifers bred to the exact same Black Angus bull. It occurs on about a 50% ratio. Calling her a foundation cow, remember I said that there's only about 22 of them left today. Those are the females that we want to breed to Angus bulls again to produce the Ona White Angus, which now is three-quarter Black Angus, and do that through the use of reproductive technologies. Here's an example of the cow about her same age, and she's a foundation cow. Again, the foundation cows are half-blood Black Angus, and then standing next to her, nursing her, is a heifer calf that is an Ona White Angus. So this was the foundation cow bred to a Black Angus bull producing the Ona White Angus, which is the white heifer calf suckling her there. Here's an example of a cow pregnant Ona White Angus at 2 years of age with our pregnant heifer herd that's calving for the first time. This is a good example of these are embryo transfer sisters, okay? So these are full sisters achieved from the same flushing. One foundation cow bred to a Black Angus bull produced a number of viable embryos. And then these two females were born about the same time, and one black, one white. This is a three-quarter Black Angus bull that we call this one of our Ona White Angus, and these are the bulls that we would be using on the Ona White Angus cows. I like this picture because I want to explain to you that these cows are purposely moderate body size. When we first started looking at this cow herd, one of the things that's quite common for beef cattle producers to do to measure cow herd efficiency is to divide the pounds of weaned calf into the pounds of pregnant dam at the time of weaning and calculate the percentage from that. So how many pounds of calf are you weaning per pound of pregnant cow at that time, the time of weaning? And every time that we do that, these Ona White Angus are at the top of our herd for two reasons. Number one, they produce average-sized calves. If we look at our weaning weights of our calves, they are average. They are not extraordinarily high. They're not at the top. But the cows are always at the bottom of our herd in terms of mature body size. So they're weaning average-sized calves from small calves. And here's an example of a bull. Now, I can assure you, the bull on the right, the black bull, is much older. But he still was young enough to make it into the sale. But this is an example of the kind of extremities that we would see in these bulls coming out of the Florida bull test, of our White Angus bull and a standard Black Angus bull coming out of the test. Here's a group of weaned yearling heifers from this year some of them you saw today, just three Ona White Angus heifers standing together. Here's one of their brothers. We kept three bulls back this year, and I'm going to show them to you when we go through them. Out of those bulls, we will probably retain one or two of them if we were to keep the herd going and then use them back on our Ona White Angus. Some people ask me about horns, and we have everything. We have horns, like you see in this young bull here. We have pulled, and we have scurves. So we've not had enough at this point to start selecting for that. But I do believe because we have all three represented, that is a characteristic that can be selected for. Another picture of an Ona White Angus heifer. You see her standing there with one of our Brahman heifers. This was taken recently, young female. She's getting ready to calve now, or may have calved. Here's an unweaned 6-month-old Ona White Angus heifer that is with her cow, or was. This young female is now weaned. Okay, so to tell you a little bit about the sale and how we're going to do it, the date for the sale is scheduled for January 21st, 2016. All of the cattle will be sold as a single group. So the sale will consist of one lot, and that will have all of the animals that are here. It'll have all the mature cows, the yearling heifers, the bulls, and all the calves that are on the side of the cows. So of those 68, all but about 3 or 4 of them are calving. So whatever calves are alive and with the cow will go with them, including the black calves. There will be some black calves too, and they'll go with them as well. The auction will be available on the internet and locally, but interested buyers need to be registered with Producers Cattle Auction before the sale. Todd Clemens and his family at Okeechobee Livestock Market are brokers with cattle producers and work with a lot of Florida cattlemen, and maybe some of you here. Todd can help us with what you would need to do to be registered, but you can also go to their website. Todd told me about this, and I did that. And right on their website, it has a buyer's information sheet. And then also the telephone number that you can call, and they will fax that sheet to you if you need them to. I get a lot of questions, particularly from individuals that are interested in the cow herd but do not reside in the United States, or maybe not in Florida. And at the owner's discretion, or the buyer's discretion, the cattle can remain here at the ranch cattle station for a defined period of time that can be renewed annually under a management contract. Irrespective of that, we will keep the females here until the time of weaning, which would be the end of June or sometime in July. We'll keep them here for the buyer, or the buyer can take them at any time. But there is an opportunity to do that. If the buyer wishes to leave the cattle here and enter into a program, a reproductive program, to begin harvesting embryos and or semen, we will work with them to achieve that here on our end. And we'll do it through a negotiated contract that would be fair to both parties to help move them along to their new home. We're always providing information updates on our website. I'm sure that many of you that have been interested in the herd have looked at our website, and we plan to continue to do that as well. We have a couple that are guests here, Bonnie Spell and Todd. And so I'm going to open it up now for any questions that folks might have. Is anybody? Yes, sir.
Are the bulls that are included the White Angus bulls?
Yeah, the question is, are the bulls that are included the White Angus bulls? They are. Every bull that, and there's eight of them, there'll be several bull calves, of course, newborns with the calf. But the current weaned bulls in the herd are all three-quarter Black Angus, Ona White Angus bulls. There's eight of them. We're going to view those this afternoon. Of those eight, three of them are yearlings. We also, regarding the bulls, it's our plan that in December, or maybe even November, one of the White Angus bulls that we're quite fond of, we're going to take to a bull stud and start to preserve semen from. Just in case the herd does not sell, we want to be positioned to continue to move forward with their propagation. If the herd does sell, that bull and all of his stored semen will go with the sale. Nothing will be retained.
Dave? I have a question about your foundational animals, okay? So these were cows, these females were born to Black Angus cows, right? Say it for me now.
Okay.
Foundation.
So the question is, explain a little more about the foundation cows. Where did they come from? Originally, when we started to recognize the production or the birth of these white calves from cows bred to Black Angus bulls, those were the original cow herd, and we made the assumption that there was zero Black Angus in them. Okay, that was the original cow herd. We had made the assumption that it was zero. There's a possibility there was some, because that was one of the original breeds used. But we made the assumption there was none. So when those cows were bred to Black Angus bulls, and they produced a white calf, we called those the foundation cows, and
okay.
That's what we had.
So the sires of those were not bulls you raised at Ona, they were bulls you purchased.
Correct. That's correct.
Registered Angus bulls.
That's correct.
Okay.
So those bulls were bulls that we purchased, registered Angus bulls. And in fact, in some cases, they could have been registered Angus bulls from our Angus project that you and I worked on.
Okay.
From the Kansas seed stock herd or the Brooksville herd. Yes, sir.
Talking about that, how many generations of pedigrees do you have on them? I mean, how far back do you go for on each cow?
Okay. The question is, what do we have for pedigrees, generations of pedigrees? Depending on how old the original dam was, it may go back three or four generations. So from 2002 until at that point when we started looking at them, we started really recording those pedigrees, I would say around 2008, 2009. So we go back three and four, some even more. But the one thing that we don't have is I can't tell you exactly which Angus bull was used. So I know it was an Angus bull because we keep our registered Angus bulls in a battery. But because that was a commercial herd, we would just use an Angus bull. Now, over the last several years, we've been recording that, because that's become important to us. But before then, it wasn't. Yes, Todd.
Is there any other herd like this that you know of anywhere in the United States?
The question is there any other herd like this that we know of? And the answer is no. We don't know of any others. There is another group, and I've gotten several questions about that. There's another group that's pursuing this same technology, but doing it through genetic modification. Are there any other questions on the webinar? Okay. Anybody have any other? Sure. Yes.
Have you done any type of genomic testing or even ultrasounding on some of those foundation cows to try to find the elite cows in the group?
The question is, have we done any genomic testing on those cows? Just recently, not on the foundation cows, but on some of the Ona White Angus cows, just recently we have been interested in a couple of different traits. So we've utilized from the American Angus Association the female GMAX test, and we've incorporated that on several of the cows in the herd. And I can share those results with you as well. We're also interested in, and I don't know if some of you have heard about the patented work out of Iowa State University, where they call it the X gene. And they identified salmonella and E. coli resistance in certain groups of cattle that are homozygous for this gene. And we became more interested in it when we found out that the homozygotes rarely ever are observed in black-hided cattle and are commonly observed in non-black cattle, reds and whites. When we go through our herd, and we've tested several of them now, if the animals are white, they would expect this homozygous trait to be highly conserved. They would expect us to see it at a large percentage. We don't see it at a large percentage because our cattle are predominantly black Angus. But what's interesting is we have several cows that are homozygous for the trait. And so kind of in that approach that we are interested in, we would like to further do genomic testing on that too. Any other questions?
Do you tend to see any sex link, so to speak, more heifers white versus bulls, or is it 50-50?
Yeah, the question is the white coloration, do we see any sex-linked ratios there? And we haven't. We haven't. It's pretty, it's been fairly uniform.
One more question. If, from a selling standpoint, what would be the number one selling point of this herd?
Yeah. So the question is, from a sales standpoint, what would be the number one selling point from the herd? We feel like that predominantly in white zebu-type cattle in warm climates, that individuals that want to introduce Angus genetics, because of the qualities that they can get from that, production traits that we're all aware of, they can do it with the Ona White Angus without changing the color of their animals. So the offspring won't be red or black, they'll be white. And so we feel like that is probably one of the strongest attributes that they have. So they can continue to pursue beef production in a tropical, subtropical environment without giving up the advantages of the dark skin, white hair coat that happens in a lot of crossbreeding programs.
Do we know they're going to be white 100% of the time when that cross back to the zebu?
So that's a good question. When you cross an Ona White Angus bull with the white zebu type animal, will they always be white? And we don't know. We anticipate yes, but we just don't know. The primary reason why we're collecting semen from this bull, because that's an area that we want to go into. There's a lot of interest in that with the Lori type cows and commercial herds. Now, I will tell you one thing, and we're going to look at that when we go now. But we just haven't had the numbers of animals to really investigate these cross-breeding type programs yet. But we had a young bull that was a yearling bull last year at this time. And he was kept by himself. And at the, attempted to be kept by himself because he was being supplemented. But he jumped in across the fence with a group of Brangus cows, black Brangus cows, and obviously bred some of them, because at the start of the calving season, these black cows have white calves on their side. Now, I don't know how many he bred, because there's some black calves in there too, and I don't know if he's their sire. We could find that out. So I don't know if it was 100% or not, but it's interesting that on black cows, that cross is producing the white calves. And we feel fairly confident that you'll see that with the white cows as well. Yes?
Do you allow the foundation cows to give birth unassisted, or do you watch them so closely that it's not really unassisted? And if you do allow them to give birth unassisted, have there been any complications?
The question is, what about birthing assistance? So all of the cows here give birth unassisted. Now, the herdsman, Austin Bateman, standing there in the back, and Clay Newman behind him, during the calving season, like right now, they're going to check these cows every day. But we don't bring them up and keep them up close and watch them throughout the day. Now, of course, the first calf heifers, I'm sure they check more than once a day, because those are the ones that we're watching. But it's not been an issue here. Body?
Does the fertility of the cows surpass, or at least compare to the rest of the herd here? The conception of the calving rates?
So the question is, what about fertility? Does it surpass our normal average? And the answer is yes, it does. These are our most fertile females at the center. However, people could argue that you're getting some hybrid vigor there. So you'd expect them to be a little more fertile, right? Maybe we're still feeling the advantages of hybrid vigor out of this herd. I don't know the answer. I can say that they are our most fertile cows, but I do believe we're getting some hybrid vigor still, that as generations go on, you would expect to lose a little bit. How about, is he in there? Can you think anything that I'm forgetting while we've got everyone here about the herd, or Austin, maybe? Can you think of anything that I should remind everybody? Yes, sir.
From the black heifers that are produced, have you had any to where they bred back a white calf?
That's a good question. So the question is, from the black heifers that are produced, they would be Ona White Angus, but black. Do we have any indication that they have produced white calves? And I don't. But we have not looked at that. And so I don't believe that they have, but it's not something that we have followed. If those cows give birth to a black heifer calf, then that heifer moves into our commercial herd and is treated as a commercial female. She leaves the White Angus herd. But she carries very similar genetics, right, to her white sister. And so there could be some opportunity for that. Would you agree with that, David? There could be, or maybe not?
We did, like 2 years ago, we did have, it was kind of interesting, we had a heifer, a white heifer, an Angus heifer that we bred to an Angus herd. She had twins. One was a black, just like a black Angus heifer, one was a solid white heifer. It's kind of interesting.
I'm glad you brought that up. I didn't think of that. So for the folks on the webinar that might not have heard that, Austin Bateman said that a couple years ago we had a cow give birth to twins, and she was a white Angus cow, and she gave birth to a black calf and a white calf.
Did she raise both of them?
Mm-hmm.
Did she perform about the same?
Mm-hmm.
Any other questions? Anna, did we get any from there?
We have six. twins.
Okay. Going once. Okay. Anybody? One comment I want to make about the sale, or maybe a couple comments. Individuals that might have an interest in ownership, but want to do it in a partnership with someone else, or are interested in them. I've had individuals ask me if they can make their names public, and so we're going to allow for that. But if you do not tell me that you want it to be public, then it'll be kept confidential. So if you register as a buyer with producers, we won't tell anybody that unless you tell me to, and then I'll post it on our list. And the reason is that there is a couple foreign investors that are only interested in business in their country. And so they may be looking for a partner to maybe form a purchase syndicate on the herd, and then work together with them. And they're not sure who that partner is. And so we have until now, until January 21st, until the sale. And so I wanted to make that known. On January 21, there's a very good chance that this herd won't sell. The reserve is $700,000, which I appreciate is a significant amount of money. If the herd does not sell, we are going to pursue continuing to propagate the herd as we're doing now. We may invest a little bit more into that effort. But after the 21st, we'll go into a continual communication and negotiation with a private individual or individuals that have the interest and the resources to commercialize the herd and offer it throughout the country or in the world. We will not break up the herd anytime soon where we'll sell, you know, small groups or individual animals. And so when bulls are culled from the herd, they're castrated, and when young females are sold, we partner with an individual and put them directly into the feedlot. So as far as I can tell you, to the extent of my knowledge, there's been no germplasm from this herd released since we've identified the coloration anomaly. So the buyer can have at least that type of assurance that this herd is staying intact. Okay, last question, time for maybe a last question. And if not, let's go and load up on one or two of the trailers, and we'll go and we'll be about, it's 3:40. We won't be more than an hour, if you, depending on kind of how your time is, if you want to make that decision, but I'd like to show you the camera.